She overcame racial prejudice to become an internationally famous contralto singer. She blazed the trail for other African-American artists, opening doors that had been previously closed to them. She is Marian Anderson, an American woman of achievement.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let us march on till victory.
I can see it now. I see Marian Anderson standing there. This huge crowd of people. And to see her singing, open air, everything, all of God's nature free. And here is where she did this beautiful concert.
On Easter Sunday, April 9, 1939, a crowd of 75,000 gathered in front of the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C. to hear African-American contralto Marian Anderson sing. Barred from performing in Constitution Hall because of her race, Anderson accepted an invitation from the Secretary of the Interior and agreed to perform on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial.
This led to a national controversy, to the extent that the First Lady of our country, Eleanor Roosevelt, resigned from the Daughters of the American Revolution. There was a standoff, and what was done was that the U.S. government stepped in.
The incident was not an isolated one, but blessed with grace and dignity, Anderson fought prejudice to become one of the world's greatest singers. Hers was a voice conductor Arturo Toscanini said, comes only once in a century.
It was far beyond just the voice. There were other contraltos, and there were other singers, and there were other artists. But her voice seemed to come from the center of the soul of everybody that listened to her. So when you heard her, you wept.
Oh, wasn't that a wide river of the Jordan? Wide river, there's one more river to cross. There's one more river to cross.
Marian Anderson never saw herself as a fighter, but she challenged written and unwritten laws governing the separation of races across America. Her victories helped ease the way for African-American singers and entertainers who would follow her.
Through it all, through all of the hardships, and through all of the trials, through all of the tribulations, and through all of the triumphs, Marian Anderson remained Marian Anderson. She never became so great that she did not remember her beginnings. She remembered her family. She remembered her friends. She remembered her church. She was always a very gracious, dignified, likable person.
Born on February 17, 1897, Marion and her two sisters, Alice and Ethel, grew up in an integrated South Philadelphia neighborhood.
Her father sold ice and coal at the Reading Terminal Market. Her mother took in laundry to supplement the income. And the center of the family was really in the church, the Union Baptist Church.
From the earliest times in her life, Marion's beautiful, rich voice stood out among others. When she was six, she began singing with the church's junior choir. 8 years later, she was asked to sing with the senior choir. For several years, Marion sang with both choirs. A popular singer, she was often asked to participate in many church benefits. It was at one of those benefits Marion met the great African-American tenor, Roland Hayes.
I think that she felt, she was very much moved by the appearances of Roland Hayes. When Roland Hayes came to do the star concerts at the Union Baptist Church, and she was impressed with his command of everything.
In Roland Hayes, Marion saw it was possible for an African-American to have a singing career. Possible, but not likely without professional training. To get that training, she turned to the only place she knew in Philadelphia, the Settlement Music School.
At the age of 15, she went all by herself, I don't think anyone advised her to do it, to a small music school in downtown Philadelphia to apply to enroll in the school. And she stood in line with everyone else. And when it became her time to receive an application, she was passed over. And the person behind the desk just kept passing the applications to the people behind Marion in line. And she didn't quite understand. I think she was bewildered. She waited until everyone was gone, and she went up. And as the story is told, the receptionist said, "And what are you doing here?" And Marion said, "I'd like to apply for music school." And the harsh reality was like a curtain coming down. The statement was, "We don't take colored here." She didn't fight it, which became typical for her whole life long. She didn't fight. She heard what was said, and she turned away and she walked home. And she spoke with her mother about it. And her mother, as she would do many times later, her mother said, "Something else will open up. An angel will appear. Someone will be raised up," I think was the word that Marion used in her autobiography. And indeed, that's what happened.
One of those angels was Anderson's high school principal, who finagled an introduction with Giuseppe Borghetti. Borghetti was a prominent Italian voice coach, a man who worked with the finest concert stars of the day, and he lived in Philadelphia.
He listened to her sing the spiritual Deep River. And as he himself said, he closed his eyes and he had just never heard a sound like that before.
Borghetti agreed to coach Marion, but there was a problem, money. Just as they had always done, though, the people of Union Baptist rallied to support Marion.
She was allowed to have concerts at the church where the proceeds would go were given to her to help her. The proceeds would be very small, because back in those days, it was very little money. But whatever she received from the concerts was given to her.
They raised enough money to pay for a year of lessons. After that, Borghetti stayed on, but never took another dime from Marion. Anderson's professional singing career was beginning to grow. She performed in small concert halls, schools, and churches. But talent alone wasn't enough to overcome racial prejudice, a constant problem, especially in the South. The so-called Jim Crow laws were in effect at the time, separating blacks from whites. Often, Anderson would find herself without a hotel room or a meal.
They got off of the train and they came back. And at the station, Marion wanted, they were hungry, a sandwich. And they would not serve her in the restaurant.
After years of performing in small venues around the country, Anderson decided she was ready for a major concert. She booked New York's prestigious Town Hall, financing the concert with her own money.
There were so few people that they held the curtain for about a half an hour, hoping more people would come, and they didn't.
Anderson performed anyway. To her delight, a reviewer was among the small audience. But the review was a deeper blow to Anderson than the empty seats.
I think we would call it a lukewarm review. And he pinpointed a problem. He said that the songs in foreign languages seemed to have been sung by rote, which means that it seemed as though she really didn't understand the languages and she didn't understand the pronunciation of the languages or the meanings behind the words very well. And it seemed that she just didn't have a handle on that yet.
Stung by the criticism and the failed concert, Marion retreated home to Philadelphia, refusing to sing. Several months later, Anderson's mother, now the family's sole support, fell ill. It was the catalyst Marion needed to pull out of her depression and begin performing again.
My aunt said that the proudest day was when she was able to call John Wanamaker's store, for whom my grandmother worked, doing menial labor and cleaning washrooms and other work. When she was able, when my aunt was able to call that store and tell the woman for whom she worked that Mrs. Anderson would not be coming into work that day or any other day in the future. So being able to take care of her mother and take care of her family, myself included, was very important.
Soon after she returned to performing, Anderson entered a contest sponsored by the prestigious National Music League. The finals of the contest were never held. Anderson so impressed the judges, she was declared the winner in the semifinals. After that, things moved quickly for Anderson. She was invited to sing in concert halls throughout the country, including New York's Carnegie Hall. She met professional concertmaster Arthur Judson. It looked like Anderson was on her way. But in America, prejudice still prevented Anderson from becoming a star. That, plus the fact that much of her concert repertoire was in foreign languages, and the sting of the reviewer's criticism that she sang without understanding the words, was still with her. Over Judson's objections, Anderson gave up her American career and went to Europe. Across the ocean, thousands filled the concert halls. In Europe, Marion fever was everywhere, and Anderson was now an international star. In Paris, she signed with international concert promoter Saul Hurac, manager to some of the most brilliant and talented entertainers of the time.
The important thing for her was the trust that she had in Hurac. There was never a written contract between my aunt and Mr. Hurac. And I am fortunate to say that I remembered Hurac, because he was so fond of my aunt that when her appearances in Philadelphia, he would usually be there.
Hurac immediately booked Marion into New York's Town Hall. This time, the results couldn't have been more different. The New York Times called her voice electrifying, full and opulent, swelling out like a mighty organ. Suddenly, Anderson found herself booked for concerts across the United States and around the world. With so much success, Hurock believed the time had come for Anderson to perform in Washington, D.C., the nation's capital.
Washington, D.C. was an important city, and it was time for her to be presented there after New York. So the hall for classical performers to perform in was the D.A.R. Constitution Hall.
There was only one problem. The dates Hurock requested were booked.
So he offered several other dates, and they were all filled. And then he got the picture, and he realized that maybe there was a problem with the fact that Marian Anderson was black. But before just confronting it, he of course, Saul Hurock knew everyone in the profession, and he just asked someone, it happened to have been Paderewski, to try for the same dates. And lo and behold, the dates were open for him.
It was something over which I know my mother and my Aunt Marian and my grandmother must have prayed a great deal, because Aunt Marian was under considerable pressure. I've seen the correspondence that others have not seen from a variety of organizations to really make more of this than she did.
The standoff was eventually resolved when the United States government stepped in and Marian Anderson stepped onto the steps of the Lincoln Memorial.
Just from seeing her, even if you just see a picture of her standing there at the microphone, and if you hear her singing that day, it had to be one of the most meaningful experiences in her life, as it was in mine.
Soon after the historic concert, the State Department commissioned a mural depicting the event. 4 years later, the mural was unveiled during a benefit concert at Constitution Hall. Not only was Anderson asked to perform, the invitation was extended by none other than the Daughters of the American Revolution. With that performance, Anderson became the first African American to take the stage at Constitution Hall. The Lincoln Memorial Concert catapulted Anderson. Now she was a superstar. So great was the demand for Marian Anderson, Hurock had to turn down engagements. Anderson had achieved the enviable position of selecting her performances. Along with her new status came a demand for better treatment. Hurock insisted on decent hotel accommodations for Anderson, or she wouldn't appear. Neither would any other Hurock-managed performer. Now, if Anderson stayed in a private home, it was by choice, not necessity. In 1941, Philadelphia awarded their homegrown treasure with the Bach Award, honoring the city's most outstanding citizen. $10,000, a huge amount of money in those days, went along with the honor. The first African American to receive the award, and only the second woman, Anderson used the money to start a scholarship program for aspiring singers.
Every October, there would be auditions held in Philadelphia, and there would be three days usually of auditions and three nights of dinners, catered dinners at home. And this was the high point of the year as far as I was concerned. Aunt Marian sometimes was there, but more often than not she was not there. But it was a matter of giving an opportunity to other singers, and that was just an extension of the way she was.
Throughout World War II, Anderson used her talents and her popularity to sell war bonds through concerts and performances around the country. A busy professional life left little free time, but there was enough time for one person in her private life. For nearly 20 years, Orpheus King Fisher had been a steady presence in Marian Anderson's life. A longtime friend and a lifelong fan, he had asked her to marry him, and she turned him down. He asked again, 20 years later. This time, she accepted.
Uncle King had a very difficult position. He was married to one of the most famous women in the world, and it was logical for people to think of him as Mr. Anderson.
The couple made their home in Danbury, Connecticut. The sprawling farm was a perfect place for Anderson to go horseback riding, garden, and relax between concert tours.
My Uncle King was a source of great humor and made my Aunt Marion very joyous at many times.
Offers to perform continued to pour in. Honors and awards were frequent. But for all the success and international acclaim, there was one place Marian Anderson had yet to perform, New York's Metropolitan Opera. All of her life, Anderson wanted to sing opera. In 1955, she finally got her chance.
At the age of 53, which is pretty far along in a singer's career, Marian Anderson made her Met debut in the role of Ulrika, who is a sorceress in an opera by Verdi called Un ballo in maschera, which means the masked ball. It was a relatively small role, but had some very beautiful singing in it. And basically, Marian Anderson broke the color barrier at the Metropolitan Opera.
Even though it was towards the end of her career, the intensity of her portrayal of Ulrika was extraordinary. And I've heard many Ulrikas after that, and I've tried to be as objective as I can be, but no one really captured the drama of that moment.
Although it took Anderson most of her career to reach the Metropolitan Opera stage, there were still more performances remaining for the singer. In 1961, she sang at the inauguration of President John F. Kennedy. The two would work together as part of her Freedom from Hunger Foundation. But the next time Anderson sang for the administration was at Kennedy's funeral. By 1964, the stress and pressure of concerts and tours took their toll. Marian Anderson decided to retire from a glorious career that had spanned 40 years. She had performed in all the major concert halls, met presidents and kings, accepted a presidential appointment to represent the African countries of Togo and Cameroon in the United Nations, and had earned the love, respect, and admiration of millions around the world. On her 75th birthday, her most ardent admirers, family and friends, honored Marian with a party at Carnegie Hall.
The thing about Aunt Marian is that she was always surprised that so long after her retirement that people would still remember her and have the kind of interest in her. The amount of mail that she would get would be constant from all over the world, people who remembered her, in some cases only from phonograph records. And sometimes when we would be out in Danbury and we'd be going along and someone would look at her and they'd say, you know, you look exactly like Marian Anderson. She says, isn't that amazing? You're the second person who's told me that today, not confirming or anything, and just going along.
On April 8th, 1993, at the age of 96, Marian Anderson died, one day shy of the 54th anniversary of her Lincoln Memorial concert. With quiet grace, dignity, and courage, Marian Anderson shattered barriers held high for centuries. With a voice heard round the world, she forced open doors once closed, blazing a bright trail that made her an American woman of achievement.
I had an aunt who said, the same as my mother, that Marian was so gracious and so stately that she did not have to sing for them. All she had to do was walk in on the stage at the Academy and kick the train and bow, and that was sufficient.
Marian Anderson, an American woman of achievement.